Victory. How many of you have ever gotten these shoes called Nike shoes? Do you know that that word Nike is the Greek word for victory? In fact, one of the ancient titles for Jesus was Christos Nike, Christ the victor. I want you to listen to this scripture that says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The word victory means one who has conquered. And that's the wonderful news in the New Testament, that Jesus has conquered for us. He's conquered death. He's conquered sin. Amen. He's conquered all that which separates us from God. And if we will have faith in him, guess what? He gives us his victory. Wow. Let me tell you something else. One of the first images that ancient Christians used of Jesus was him sitting on a throne. That's where they got this term, Jesus, Jesus Christos Nike, Christ the victor. The Bible says that he rose from the dead and then he has been exalted now to the right hand of God, to the throne of honor and glory, because he has been the victor over sin and death. Hallelujah. For God the Father and for all of humanity that will believe in him. And guess what it says in Ephesians? That he has raised us up, those who believe in him, and have caused us to sit with him now on his throne in the place of victory. And so that's what I love about this word, that God has given us victory through Jesus Christ. If we will believe in him, if we will have faith in him, we receive his victory. Now, the interesting thing is sometimes it doesn't look like it right on this earth that we've got victory. We still deal with issues. We still suffer. We still have pain. But the truth is, if we have faith in Jesus, we have the victory and we can overcome. We have his abundant life now. We have his eternal life now. We have his power against the devil now, against sin now. And we have his spirit, the Holy Spirit, that transforms us to cause us to be like him, his holiness, his character. That is true victory. Hallelujah. You have the victory right now in Jesus Christ. And what we must do is walk in it. We must believe it. We must trust in him moment by moment. I'm giving you this one more scripture where it says, 1 John 5, verse 4 through 5, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he or she who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you believe he's the Son of God? As we believe in him, we gain and we have the victory. Keep on standing in the victory. Keep on walking in the victory of Christ. Keep on exercising the victory against sin and over death and over all the things that want to keep us down. Hallelujah. You're more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. Amen. You and I are who he says we are, the children of God. We're not what other people say we are. Amen. Hallelujah. So come on and receive and love and live in and believe in the victory that Jesus Christ has already won, and that you sit with him in that place of victory even now in Jesus' name. Victory. Hallelujah.
Looking for more West State TV original content? Like and subscribe to make sure you never miss a video. Yeah.
Let's praise the name of Jesus on this morning, beloved. Oh, come on now. This is a good opportunity to give the Lord praise. Come on now, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen. This is a day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice. Things may not be going like I want them to, but I will rejoice in it. Amen. Let's give the Lord praise if you're glad on this morning. Give yourselves a hand, amen, for making it to the right place at the right time, and you may be seated. Welcome to West Angeles. Welcome home. No matter who you are, no matter where you have come from, we want you to know that we love you, and we welcome you to church on this morning. We're going to begin our time together on this morning now with our very special announcements from our Voice of Hospitality.
Good morning, West Angeles. At this time, we pause in our services to give a warm West Angeles family welcome to our online viewing audience. Amen. They deserve a hand clap. Amen. Now, for those of you that are visiting West Angeles for the first time, please stand and remain standing until you've been greeted. All visitors, please stand. Amen. On behalf of our pastor, Bishop Charles E. Blake, and his lovely wife, Lady May, and the entire West Angeles family, we say welcome. We are happy that you chose West Angeles as your place of worship on this morning. We hope that while you're here, you will join in with us and enjoy the blessings of the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Now, if you did not receive a visitor's card, raise your hand and an usher will provide you with a card. Take a moment to complete this card and place it in the offering receptacle at that time of worship. We are very happy that you came to West Angeles this morning. Please come back and join us again. You may be seated. Our announcements are as follows. Please keep the following bereaved families in prayer. Yolanda Ragland, who lost her mother. Marlon Culpepper, who lost his brother-in-law. Flora Wells, who lost her son. Apostle Director Pauletta Barrett Oliver, who lost her mother. Funeral services will be held at the North Campus for Dr. Arthur G. Collins, Tuesday, October 2nd, 2018, at 1 p.m. Funeral services will also be held for Helen Ragland, Wednesday, October 3rd, 2018, at 11 a.m. This concludes my portion of the announcements. Please direct your attention to the monitors and have a very blessed week. Amen.
My name is Monet Davis, and these are your West Angeles video announcements.
Attention, all West Angeles members. If you love to sing and desire to be a part of one of our singing aggregations, love to dance and desire to be a part of one of our dance ministries, we have a place for you. Please join us for the Music and Worship Arts Ministries New Member Orientation, a new time and place, immediately following the 11 a.m. service. Please come prepared to stay for at least 1 hour following service. We hope to see you there.
The prayer ministry here at West Angeles will be having the shut-in October the 4th and 5th from 7 to midnight. You don't want to miss it. It's Thursday night, Friday night here in the North Campus. It's going to be awesome. So come and help us pray. Help us pull down some stronghold. Help us to break through. And God's going to do something great. We believe in miracles. The Bible says signs and wonders shall follow them that believe.
Hey guys, join us Sunday, September 30th, 1 week after Now Generation Sunday at the West Angeles Youth Center. That's 3010 Crenshaw Boulevard. We're having an open house, and we want you to come and be our special guest. Tell them why, B.
Well, we want you to meet the directors that are over these departments like the Children's Ministry, Youth Ministry, the crew, Education and Enrichment. We want you to find out about all these different things we have to offer. And if you come out, there might be some food also. You never know.
Yeah, so take advantage of these great resources that your church offers you. Did you know that with Education and Enrichment Ministry, they offer SAT prep, college readiness.
Scholarships too.
Scholarships, yeah. Sponsorships. They help families who are going off to college. Maybe you don't know how to fill out your forms. Well, there's somebody to help you with that. Maybe your child needs after-school help, tutoring.
Oh, yeah.
Special tutoring.
Dynamic.
Programming. All these different things. Listen, there's something for everyone. Take advantage of what West Angeles Church is offering you. We'll see you Sunday, September 30th. Come out. We really want to meet you. We want to get to know who you are.
God bless you, West Angeles. We love you.
Calling all brothers at West Angeles Church. Brotherhood Ministries presents Seasoning the World. This takes place October 19th and the 21st. Yours truly will be speaking at 7 p.m. on the North Campus on the 19th, and I'll be talking about the scouting report, where you can determine the strengths, weaknesses, and tendencies of your opponent. You absolutely want to be there. And on the 21st, none other than Bishop Marvin Winans will bring a word from the Lord.
In other words, if I fall down, the Holy Ghost says, get up.
My brothers, I'm looking forward to seeing you all there, and we're going to have a good time in the Lord. God bless you, and we'll see you in October.
Join the Crew Ministry on October 12th, that's a Friday. Crew stands for Creating Righteous Effective Worshipers. We love to see you as we host Fajita Friday in the Crystal Room from 6:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. We'll have lots of fun, fellowship, food, gospel karaoke, and some light entertainment. Look for us on the concourse at the end of each service on Sunday, and we'll have tickets available for you to purchase, or you can contact the crew office at 323-733-8300, extension 2610. Come join us this Wednesday at 7 p.m. Ambassador Susan Johnson Cook will speak at Pastor's Bible Study. The former presidential advisor, pastor, author, and activist always has an anointed word.
You never took a drink in your life, but you got an alcoholic in your family. You between a rock and a hard place. Okay, single sisters, you got two men interested in you. One's at your house eating a piece of pound cake. The other's on the cell phone saying, I'm on my way over. You between a rock in a hard place. Anybody ever been there?
If you need revelation and confirmation of the Word of God, you would not want to miss it. I'll see you there this Wednesday.
Good morning, West Angeles. I'm your assistant pastor, Elder Charles E. Blake II. Do me a favor. turn to your neighbor and ask them, have you downloaded the Pray.com app yet? And if they say no, tell them that they're missing out on some good prayer and fellowship. Just listen to what they're saying about Pray.com around the world.
Has anybody ever need a prayer for something and wish you had a way to get the most amount of people in the shortest amount of time to pray for it? Anybody ever been there?
I've been praying about a way to make prayer more of a reality.
This app's going to help you do that.
It's an app where we have prayer at our fingertips.
Now remember, your information will not be shared. And guess what? You can even post your prayer requests anonymously. So go to your Google Play or your Apple Store and download Pray.com and type in West Angeles Church, after service, of course, and you can be connected in prayer with your West Angeles family. Now, if you have any questions, please stop by the Pray.com table today, and we look forward to praying with you together as family.
This concludes our announcements. My name is Monet Davis, and my God will do just what he said he would do.
Let's stand together as we sing our morning hymn, Deeper, Deeper, found on the first page of your bulletin and on the screens.
Bless it.
standing for prayer.
My soul loves Jesus. My soul loves Jesus. My soul loves Jesus. Bless His name. He's a wonder. We come to you as humble as we know how. We come thanking and praising you for your mighty acts, your loving kindness, and your tender mercy. God, you've been so good to us. You've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Thank you for the angels of this great house. For the angels of this great house. In the name of Jesus. Prosper them in health, even as their souls prosper. In the name of Jesus. Strengthen, encourage the discouraged. Keep back the hand of sickness, death, accidents, and diseases. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Bless the West Angeles family, friends, and neighbors. In the name of Jesus. Touch, heal, set free, and deliver. In the name of Jesus. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. Bring down the high blood. Bring up the low blood. Take the sugar out of the blood. Dry up cancer in the name of Jesus. Somebody need a heart transplant. Somebody need a kidney transplant. Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. Thou art an able God. You're able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Joints up in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Have your way, God. Have your way. We're gonna give you all the glory. We're gonna give you all the honor, for it all belongs to you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. Our scripture this morning is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 7 through 10. And you'll find that on the monitors to my left and my right, or on page 2 of the bulletin. And we will read in unison. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages of this glory. For none of the rulers of this age knew, for had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. May God add a blessing. Amen.
Well, praise the Lord, West Angeles. Can we put our hands together and give the Lord a great applause in this place? Come on, if you're grateful, put those hands together. Come on, open your mouth and shout to the Lord with the voice of triumph. Come on, give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. Come on, put those hands together like this.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord for his goodness to me. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord for his goodness to me. For his mercy enduring forever. Oh, give thanks. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord.
Come on, say it.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord
for his goodness to me.
Oh, give thanks
unto the Lord
for his goodness to me. For his mercy enduring
forever.
Come on, say it again.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord
for his goodness to me.
Oh, give
thanks unto the Lord
for his goodness to me.
For his mercy enduring
forever. Oh, give thanks.
good to you. You ought to give him praise. You ought to open your mouth and give him praise. Praise, praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Come on, let's continue in that flow. Everybody lift up your hands to the Lord. Come on, in this moment, lift up your hands to the Lord and begin to worship him. Come on, open your mouth and bless him all over the room. Bless the name of the Lord Jesus. Come on, lift up your hands and worship him. Glory to God, glory to God. Often we depend on the music, no music right now. Everybody lift up your voice. Come on, fill this cathedral with worship. Come on, bless the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, that's good, but you need to do a little bit better. Come on, turn the volume up on your worship. Hallelujah, Lord, we can't forget what you've done. And we bless you in this house this morning. We honor your presence. Glory to the name of Jesus. Bless the name of the Lord. Listen, I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, no matter what you're facing, no matter what you've been through, God meant it for his glory and for your good. If you believe that, put your hands together and believe that the best is yet to come for you. Hallelujah. Listen to this simple song. It says, it's gonna happen. It's on the way. My miracle, my breakthrough. For Lord, you promised. Your word is true. It's gonna happen. It's on the way. Come on, everybody sing it.
It's gonna happen.
It's on the way.
It's on the way.
Come on, declare it. My miracle.
My miracle.
My breakthrough.
My breakthrough.
For Lord, you promised.
Oh, Lord, you promised.
And your word is true.
Your word is true.
It's going to happen.
It's gonna happen.
It's on the way.
It's on the way.
If you believe that, come on, clap your hands and give God praise for it. Hallelujah. Come on, sing it again. Your neighbor, your miracle,
your miracle,
your breakthrough,
your breakthrough.
For he has promised,
for he has promised,
his word is true,
his word is true.
It's gonna happen,
it's gonna happen.
Come on, let's sing it. It's gonna happen,
it's gonna happen.
Hallelujah! Oh, yes, now let's declare this. Say it with my heart. That creates an atmosphere for God to move. And this morning, because of what we anticipate him to do in our lives, we have an obligation to praise the Lord. Come on, we have an obligation to praise the Lord. Join us with the Cathedral Chorale as they encourage us this morning. Praise ye the Lord. Come on, let's put our hands together and bless him.
Every place in the firmament of his power.
But beloved, you heard them. They said, praise ye the Lord. Oh, let's give him praise because he's worthy. Let's give him praise because he is faithful. Let's give him praise because his mercy is new every morning. Praise ye the Lord. Well, beloved, we've come to a very, very special and important part of our service on today. We come to the time where we like to do what they call passing the peace. So we're going to pass peace to our neighbor on this morning. I want everyone in the house of the Lord to stand on up, amen, on those two good legs that God gave you. It's a blessing to be able to stand. And I want you to go to at least five of your brothers and sisters in Christ and say to them, welcome home. To say here that no matter who you are, no matter where you're from, no matter your ethnicity, no matter your background, we say to you that we consider you family, that we love you like family. We say to you, welcome home. So praise the Lord for your neighbors on this morning. Praise the Lord for those around you, worshiping the Lord with you. They're here to let you know that you are not alone, that you are loved, amen? Amen. Let's praise the Lord for our pastor and our leader, Bishop Charles E. Blake, Sr. Amen. Oh, come on, beloved. We can do better than that. The man has been traveling around all week. We are so happy that he is home. Amen. Let's also praise the Lord for the First Lady of West Angeles Church, Lady May L. Blake. Yes, sirree. We love our leaders. We are sitting next to Lady May on her left is Sister Karen Jackson. Let's praise the Lord for her. And Sister Karen has faithfully attended West Angeles for most of her life, and she is literally a part of the fabric of West Angeles, and she loves her church, and she loves singing in the Women's Day Choir. How many of y'all love singing in the Women's Day Choir? Amen. Well, she worked in the music studio with Brother Philip Bailey of Earth, Wind, and Fire and Lionel Richie and Mary Wilson of the Supremes. And she also has done in-home services and is a patient navigator for the Urban League. And she is also a part of the Urban League Guild. And she is a one-year cancer survivor. Amen. Let's praise the Lord that he's a healer. Amen. And again, Sister Jackson, will you please stand? Again, I know you stood up once before, but let's stand up one more time so we can welcome you properly. Well, we also want to praise the Lord for so many of our special friends and visitors that saw fit to worship the Lord with us on today. Let's give our visitors another hand. Amen. And all of you who blessed us with your presence on this morning, we want to especially welcome Bishop Bobby Hutnall and his wife, co-pastor Renee Hutnall from Life in the Word Church of Jesus Christ in Virginia. And they're here in Los Angeles celebrating their 30th wedding anniversary. 30 years, amen. Would you all please stand so that we can praise the Lord for you on today? And amen. Oh, praise the Lord, there you are. And we also want to welcome our friend, Los Angeles City Attorney Mike Feuer, to church on this morning. Let's praise the Lord for him. Amen. And we are definitely praying for you. You have a tough job ahead of you and in the middle of it right now. Well, let's also praise the Lord for our friend and our brother, Bishop T. Larry Kirkland of the AME Church. Amen. We always have a good time in the Lord when he is with us. And well, we just want to send out a special thank you to Deacon David Moore and the Brotherhood organization. And they had an awesome breakfast and discussion on prostate cancer last Saturday. And also a very, very special thank you to Deacon Mark Roberson for coordinating such a very insightful and open and candid event. And we praise the Lord for our brotherhood. Let's praise the Lord again for the Brotherhood. Well, we also want to send another very special thank you to our youth sector, along with everyone who participated in Now G Sunday on last week. Amen. And each speaker was phenomenal, and our young people did an absolutely fabulous job during each service. And Elder Blake wanted me to remind you that on October 12th, I think it's the Tuesday after next, they're going to be having a very special Friday Fajita Fellowship. Amen. And you all can come on out. It's going to be in the Crystal Room, and tickets are only $10. So to get your ticket, just give our young adult or Elder Blake's office a call, and you too can enjoy you some fajitas. Wait a minute. That's not Tuesday. It's called Friday Fellowship. So I guess it can't be on next Tuesday then. Oh, well, we're working on out. Amen. October 12th. Amen. So let's praise the Lord again for the work that our youth and young adults in our youth sector is doing. Well, we want everyone to, that is Friday Fajita Fellowship. I'm hungry. Amen. Y'all going to have to excuse me on this morning. I got fajitas in my spirit. Amen. All up here. Amen. But we want everyone to please join us for our midweek pastoral Bible study on this Wednesday evening when the great Reverend Dr. Susan Johnson Cook, a former ambassador at large. Amen. Let's praise the Lord for her. Well, Reverend Dr. Suzanne Johnson Cook, a former ambassador at large for the International Religious Freedom under President Barack Obama, will be our guest speaker. Everyone come out, I promise you, a good time in the Lord. And also, please come on back for our 7 p.m. service on this evening, where our evangelist missionaries will be in charge, and Dr. Catherine Gray will be speaking. And let's praise the Lord for our evangelist missionaries that prayed for us and read scripture on this morning. Amen. Well, beloved, let's all now stand and give the Lord praise as we are now blessed by our pastor and leader, Bishop Charles E. Blake, Sr.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. He is worthy to be praised and adored. So just lift up holy hands in one accord. Sing, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Come on, sing. He's worthy. He's worthy. He is worthy. To praise the Lord. I love to praise Him. I love to worship Him. I love to glorify His name. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt His name together. Has the Lord been good to anybody? Come on, give Him praise. Give Him worship. The choir cannot praise Him for you. They can help you praise Him, but they can't praise Him for you. Singers and the musicians cannot praise Him for you. You've got to praise Him for yourself. Clap your hands and give praise unto the Lord. Please be seated. Greetings to all of you in the name of Jesus. What a wonderful array of observations and announcements and acknowledgments have been made on this morning. Thank God for a church that is so busy and doing so many wonderful things, prostate cancer clinic and focus and our youth program that was so wonderful on last week and all the great things that we're hearing about. Come on, let's thank God for a church that's busy. And you know, I'm really convinced that our best days are still ahead. God is still blessing us, taking us higher. And He's still working miracles on our behalf. Come on, praise God for your miracle. And I proclaim in the name of Jesus that you will not leave here as you were when you came. The Lord is still the same as He was in Bible days. And He performed wonderful miracles and signs and wonders. God is able to do the same thing to do today. Whatever you need. Whatever you long for, whatever you desire, God can do it. Look over toward your neighbor and just say, neighbor, God can do it. Would you by faith just thank God for what He's going to do in your life? You won't leave here as you were when you came. The Spirit of the Lord is still the same. Let's praise God for the wonderful lady by my side, Lady Mae Blake. Bishop Kirkland, it's a joy to see you on today. Mike Fuhrer, city attorney, we're overjoyed to have you present in the house of the Lord with us. And we're glad to see evangelist Harold Woodson. Let's give him a rousing applause. So many wonderful things are happening. And we thank God for His presence with us on this day to bring a blessing and strength and encouragement to our hearts and to our souls. Erica Ash, where are you? Run up here, Erica, wherever you are. Come quick, come quick, come quick, come quick. You're younger than I am, so I'll let you come to me. I was about to receive the tithe and the offerings, and I went down on the main floor, and Erica gave me a wonderful miracle testimony that the Lord had given to her through tithing. And I just want her to say what she said to me. Tell what God did for you.
Well, just to let you up, good morning, first of all. Good morning, West Angeles. Thank you very much for letting me share. I was raised in the church, and I was always taught to tithe. And I've always been a bit of a problem child for my two pastor parents, because my thoughts are, listen, I'm getting up early in the morning to go to work, and this is my money. Why am I giving 10% of it away? So I never really faithfully tithe throughout my life, but I spoke to Bishop maybe two Sundays ago, and it just came over my spirit after having been coming here for so long and having not tithed, just giving whatever offering I felt like I wanted to give that particular Sunday, depending on the way my bills were set up for that month. I said I was going to just try it because I'd just been hearing so many wonderful things. So I started tithing, and then a trial came up in terms of my home, and I thought, maybe I won't tithe this particular Sunday. Maybe I'll just hold off because I need my money for my bills. But what I realized in that moment when I came to church was tithing is not about the money. Tithing is about the trust. So for me, I decided that tithing meant trust in the Lord, his mercy endureth. So I said, okay, I'm just going to give this tithe and I'm going to see what happens. And I promise you, by the end of that week, something happened where I owed the IRS a ton of money, and my accountant called me. He'd been calling me all day. It was Friday after that Sunday that I had given the tithe that I was unsure about giving. And I finally got to him by the end of the day, and he said, your day is going to be so much better by the time we get off the phone. He told me that he had called to figure out a payment plan for this incredible amount, like incredible, like I owed so much money, I literally wanted to just sit down and bury my face in my hands and just cry. He was calling to figure out a payment plan for how much I owed the IRS and found out that they had made a mistake. They actually owed me that money. So, amen. It was within 1 week of making that commitment to the Lord that I was unsure of making. And not only did it absolve the debt that I owed, but also took care of my home problems all in one. So my message to you today, West Angeles, is to trust in God. Tithing is trusting in God and showing him that you are going to be faithful and trust him to do what it is that he promised. Because like the choir sang, your miracles are coming. They're on their way. Please tithe. Thank you.
Come on, let's praise the Lord for Sister Erica. Well, what more can I say? Let's prepare to give to the work of the Lord. Tithers, would you please stand? Those of you on the internet, you have the instructions on your screen as to how you can participate in this time of giving. All of you here, I want you to give the best offering you can give to support the work of the Lord and to bring glory to his wonderful name. I'll pray briefly for the tithers, and then I'll pray for the entire audience, and then we will give and share with the work of the Lord. Dear Lord, bless these tithers who obey your word. Respond, dear Lord, to your demand for that which is yours. We joyously set your tenth aside, and we present it to you with all joy in our hearts, in Jesus' name. And we believe the blessing that is promised in the word of God. Everybody in God's house, please stand. Everyone stand. Dear Lord, bless all your people who give, who share, who bring their gifts before you. In every area of their lives, prosper their way. In the name of Jesus, and just as you work that miracle for Erica, work miracles for all of your people. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank God. Amen. Clap your hands and praise God for the privilege of giving. Be seated. The ushers will come and serve you. The choir will sing. Let's worship the Lord in giving.
Hallelujah. Let's thank God for what he's going to do. Yes. Let's praise him for the anticipation of how he's going to break every chain over our lives. Let's celebrate the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We magnify your name. Woo.
been in ministry and a full-time evangelist for more than 50 years. For more than 30 years, he's been a dear friend of West Angeles. I was preaching for the Church of God, Cleveland, large Pentecostal denomination. He was my host for the day, and we became friends, and for 30 years, that friendship has continued. And he has blessed West Angeles many times by his ministry. He was born in Portersville, California, grew up in North Carolina and Arkansas. He now lives in Tampa, Florida. He's a man of God that travels across this nation, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, encouraging and lifting the hearts of men and women. After this choir comes and sings another song, they've been such a blessing to us throughout this entire service. Let's praise God for them. After they have sung, the next voice you will hear will be that of Evangelist Harold Woodson of Tampa, Florida.
I dreamed of a city called glory. So bright and so fair. When I entered the gates, I cried, "Holy!" The angels all met. I said,
worthy. I want to see Jesus, the one who died for me. I need that crying holy, oh, holy. I cry.
Come on, lift your voice and give him a praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Honor him. Glorify him. Bless his name. Bless his name. Hallelujah. 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 Bless his name. Bless his name. I would always acknowledge, first of all, Bishop Blake. This man and his wife and his family have been a friend to me, a friend to me. You don't understand that. A friend. And I honor you. I was okay till he sung that song.
Yes, I know. Glory. Hallelujah. Glory. Yes. Glory.
I have not preached since August the 6th. I buried my brother, and they sung that song, and And I was complaining to the Lord. I said, Lord, all those prayers we prayed. He was my only sibling. And I said, after he passed, I said, Lord, all those prayers we prayed, were they in vain? And the Lord said to me something. It shook me up. He said, when I decide to receive someone unto myself, I don't consult you, his wife, nor his mother. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You better help me shout. Because that is the hope that when you leave this building today, my mother's 88 years old. She lives with me, has for 11 years. And I showed Elder a picture of her a while ago. I said, that looks like a Holy Ghost Pentecostal lady, don't it? And she's still one of them old-fashioned Pentecostals. But she walked up at the casket of my brother, her only other child, and she grabbed the grandchildren around her, his two daughters and my daughter and two sons. Well, my daughter wasn't there. And she looked at them and she said, do you plan on seeing your daddy again? And they just kind of looked at her like, well, Mama, that don't sound nice. And she looked at him. She said, I said, do you plan on seeing your daddy again? And then she looked at my son and said, and are you planning on seeing your uncle again? Well, yes, they were real nice. It's grandma. She can say whatever she wants to. How many know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
She said, if you plan on seeing him after they close that lid on that box, you better get your act together. Because if you don't get your act together, you ain't going to see him anymore. I need to say to some of you, if you plan on seeing the best that's yet to come, you better get your act together. I don't care what church you go to, what religion you claim. You better make sure you're going to see heaven in Jesus' name. Somebody give God a praise if you love him. All right. You may be seated. I believe I can preach now. When the dear lady came up to testify, by the way, choir, you're awesome. Lady Judy. Got that big old hair now. I was looking around for you and I couldn't find you. Then I saw you. I love this church. I was privileged to be around when you were building it. And I came one day and Lady May was showing me around the church. You will never guess which room she wanted to show me first. The ladies' bathroom. And when she wanted to show me, I went to it. Hadn't been back since, but I went that day. I love you and bless you. Elder, what an awesome young man you are, and your brother and your sister. I love you and I bless you. But when that young lady came up and gave that testimony, the Lord gave me a word that's not even listed on what I'm preaching. But I'm going to read it to you. It's Hebrews 11. Verse 2. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. That is so often what happens when it's time for the tithe and the offering. You are converted, but are you convinced? You believe the word as it is written. If somebody asks you, do you believe in tithing? Yes. Do you believe in giving to God? Yes. Do you believe in being faithful to the house of God? Yes. But are you converted to it? And the reason I ask this is because after 50 years, over 50 years of ministry, every church that I go to, no matter how large or how small, especially the larger it is, somehow we are converted to the gospel. We're converted to the importance of the house of God, but I'm not sure we're convinced. And the reason I say that is because almost every large church, particularly that I go to, when the service begins, it looks like Custer went through Atlanta. Now, if you don't know what that is, that was the Civil War. It looked like Sherman went through Atlanta. Because we're slow to get there. And so oftentimes we miss the part that God had in mind for us. You're slow, but you're worth waiting on. We have four services at our church. We only seat like 1,200, and we have four services. And it doesn't matter how many times we change the time of the service, they're still 30 minutes late. Oh, but you don't live in Los Angeles. Yeah, but I live in Tampa. We get there sometime and leave before the offering, or we get there sometime after the praise and worship. I don't care what church you go to. Are you convinced that God's word is yes and amen? Read it again. Unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them. How can it be that the word is preached, but it does not profit us? He said, simple. Because you don't hear it with faith. You don't act in faith. You don't tithe in faith. You either do it because it's a habit, or you do it because we need to pay bills. But God said the reason the word is the word, but the word does not profit you, is that you hear the word, but you don't mix it with your faith. What in the world would happen if every time you paid your tithe and every time you gave to God, you expected God to keep His part of the word? Preach on, Brother Woodson. I think I will. You started this, Bishop. You started this, lady, when you talked about that tithing. We don't comprehend that when you give to God, you are fulfilling God's word. So how dare you give and not believe that God is going to give back to you when it was His word long before it was your word? My dad had a deacon in his church that he would tithe part of the time if he felt like it. As she said, and as all of us have said, if the bills were right, not realizing that what you do in the sight of God, God sees it as an act of obedience. Let me help you with something. If you don't hear nothing else I say, hear this. Obedience. Oh, God. Obedience. One act of obedience changes everything. When I had the nerve He was my brother. When I had the nerve to say to God, God, I've never heard of so many people praying for a preacher of a small church. He wasn't a small man. When Bishop would come back and preach for us at the Church of God in Georgia, my brother escorted you. He drove you. He was a big man, much larger than I am. Never been sick. And one moment, the doctors informed me you have fourth stage cancer and gave him less than 6 months to live. He could not comprehend it. We could not comprehend it. If you hug my brother, it was like hugging a tree. He was big and strong. And in 2 months, he was gone. And when I had the nerve to say to God, and don't look at me funny because you've had the nerve to say a few things to God. I said, God, how could this be? And the Lord said to me, when I decide to receive some, you know, we forget a whole lot in church that we're supposed to know. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My father was so funny. He said, all of you folk in church, you'll be telling me how homesick for heaven you are. And every time you get sick, you go to the drugstore and get you a bottle of Stay Here. You're not near as homesick as you act like you are. Turn and look at somebody and say, have you had any Stay Here lately? Yet I know, like you know, that as long as there is breath in my body, we have a song we sing almost every service anymore because it's become part of us in our being. The breath that is in my body, the breath, it's your breath. The other day, Judy, I was listening to them sing, and for the first time I said, God, I'm going to pay attention to the words. Every breath is God's breath in me. And I looked up and I said, God, my brother doesn't have breath on this earth anymore. So as long as I have breath, I'm going to praise you. Every time I see Bishop or talk to him on the phone, how are you? And I mean it from my heart, because you don't realize the stress that this man goes through being who he is. If you did, you would pray for him more than you do. You would do more than just give some little nice little glib about our wonderful angel, our wonderful pastor. If you really believe that he was in the will of God and you really believe that he is the man of this hour, you would pray for him every single day. Because like me, like him, like you, like anyone else, there will be a day when they will roll a box down. And we will come together and think of all the things we wish we had said to him and all the things we wish we had done for him. But at that moment, the Lord says, well done, my good and faithful servant, enter in. And when that day comes, he does not consult the wife, the children, the siblings, are nobody else. He says, that's my child. Before he was yours, he was mine. My mother's 88 years old, and for several weeks, it's been tough with her. Finally, the other morning, she walked into the breakfast table. I try to fix her breakfast every morning. I know what she wants, how she wants it. She walked in, she said, well, I made a decision last night. I said, well, good. What did you decide? I'm not going to mourn anymore. My son is in heaven. What better could I ask? I raised him to go to heaven. He did what he could here, and now he's with the Lord. She said, I think I'll shout. See, even some of you can't clap about that, because all you can think about, oh. And the Lord said to me just very nicely but abruptly, he says, I didn't ask you. He lived for me. When I'm ready for you, I'll receive you. The word preached did not profit you because you didn't mix it with your faith. Turn with me in Hebrews 11. I'm going to read the whole chapter quickly. Hebrews 11. You ready? Now faith, through faith, by faith, by faith, but without faith, by faith. I'm in verse 7 already. by faith, through faith, in faith, by faith. I'm in 17 now. By faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, through faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, through faith, through faith. That's the whole chapter. He says, if you don't mix your conviction with your faith, it doesn't profit you anything. That's why there's a lot of church folk sitting in church, fussing at God, upset with God. God, I thought you said you'd do this. I thought you'd say you'd do the other. How come it didn't happen that way for me? And God turns around and he says, because you did not mix your conviction with your faith. You must mix it with your faith. How dare you act like you trust in God, you believe in God, you stand by God's word. In God we trust. How pitiful that we don't. We trust more in political parties than we do God. You ain't ready for me today. I'm loaded. How is it? My dad was a strange guy to some of his coherents and his buddies and his preacher friends, because in the 50s, the early 50s, in the state of Arkansas, my dad was about the only Pentecostal preacher that I knew that had a mixed congregation. You don't know what that means? Black, white, red, yellow, literally. And they refused to promote my father in his own denomination because of what they considered him to be. That wasn't very nice in the 50s. My dad one day walked into my mother and she was offended by what someone had said to him. And he said, Marie, the Lord spoke to me. I'm going to go to heaven. And how can I go to heaven praying for people in Africa and aren't willing to associate with them in Arkansas? See, they were convicted of certain things, but they weren't convinced. We have never lived in an age that we're living in right now, where there is more ridiculous stuff that goes on under the guise of religion and being a good neighbor. And I almost want to say to sometime, like my mother said to her grandchildren, if you want to see him again, you better get your act together now. It's more than political. We have more than a race problem. We got a sin problem. Preach on, Brother Woodson. I'm going to. I have seen people take the Bible and use it as an excuse or a reason for their political stances. You better get your act together. We've got a sin problem on our hands. And we've got it oftentimes in the middle of the church because we act like we believe, but we don't add our faith to our belief. That's good preaching. Thank you. Now watch this. But without faith. This will mess with you. Without faith, it's impossible. I remember when you were building this building, and R.W. Shambach put a tent on this building. You blessed them to let them do that. Sanctified the grounds, prayed over it with the church, and then had that tent revival. No wonder God's blessed this place. Say amen. But I want to capture this in your spirit. I wasn't going to preach this way, but I want to capture this in your spirit. That again, it's important that you hear it and you believe it and understand it. The word preached does not profit them because they don't mix it with their faith. When you begin to build this building, it was absolutely, I have told this all over the United States, that you actually were blessed, this local church was blessed with the largest amount that any one bank ever loaned to a church, period, anywhere. No, don't pat a cake, you better thank God. Because the good news is Bishop has already declared that by his birthday, we're going to pay the whole thing off. Now you ought to shout. I have admired this man for years. For one of the things that you need to understand is his faith. He didn't just announce we're going to do something. I've heard a whole lot of preachers announce what they're going to do. And they didn't do nothing. But everything this man announced that you were going to do, you have done it. You ought to shout. You ought to thank God. Because he is not only a man of faith, he's a man of integrity. I tell people that I know, that I meet all over the United States and the world, the one thing about Bishop Charles Blake is he's a man of integrity. If he tells you he's going to do it, he does it. God has no problem with what kind of house you live in, what kind of car you drive, what you do, as long as God is first. I remember a number of times that people tried to buy him a certain kind of car that was supposed to move him up to a class. What they didn't understand, it wasn't a car that moved you to class. And he would say, I'm not getting rid of that old Mercedes. I mean, it was old too. Wasn't it? He said, I'm not going to do it till we get in the church. Then whatever you want to buy me, you can buy me. Then after that, he said, no, you can't. And finally, God gave him such favor because of his faithfulness and his faith. See, faithfulness and faith go hand in hand. It's one thing for you to come down and say, oh, I'm going to give $1 million. But it's something else when you see people do it. Hello. Well, if I had their money, I guess I would. No, you wouldn't. You would only give then what you give now. Am I preaching all right? Is this okay? Make me wait another year before I come back. I have watched again and again when the ministry did not mix their faith with their trust. And finally, God just said, okay, I'm tired of folk trying to give you a car or buy you a car. I'm going to have somebody give you one and then another. And then another. And some of you say, man, well, I guess if, you know, if my name was Blake, I guess somebody'd give me one. No, they wouldn't. People only want to give to something they see that is profited. My grandmother was 86 years old when she passed. I never saw her in a new house. She lived in a wood plank house until the wood turned black. They didn't paint it black. It turned black. But my grandmother was the one that taught me to give. We would go to church and she would reach in her pocket and pull out 50 cents to my brother and I when we were just little lads. And she'd say, when they pass the plates today, you give that because God blesses you when you give. Well, because my grandma said it, I knew is the truth. It wasn't till later on that I looked back and said, but God, she never had a driver's license. She never had a car. She would hitchhike to go to town. She always had two dresses. It didn't matter how many we bought her, and we bought her a bunch, but she would have two. One to work in, one to go to town and church in. We'd say, Grandma, what'd you do with that dress? Well, I gave it to somebody. They needed it. I said, but Grandma, you need it. No, I don't. I got one for church and one to work in. See, we don't understand that. We really don't. But then God comes along and he says, but without faith, no matter what you are about to do. How many of you have a dream? There's something that you have not yet accomplished that you are believing God for that dream to come to pass. Raise your hand. Then catch this. But without faith. He does not say it's hard to please God. He does not say it's difficult to please God. He doesn't say there's a Baptist way, a Methodist way, a Presbyterian way, a Church of God way, an Assembly of God way, a Church of God in Christ way, a one God, two God, three God, glory to God way. There's only one way. There's only one way to please God, by faith. But without, say it with me, but without faith. Now think for a moment, whatever it is you are believing God to help you do, think for a moment. Without faith. It's not hard to please God. It's not difficult to please God. It is impossible to please God. You can be convicted of the right doctrine. You can be convicted of the right way to do it. Do the do's, don't the don'ts. But the do's can't save you and the don'ts can't damn you. It's who you believe in that makes a difference. Now watch what he says. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Two things. For he who comes to God, say that's me. Say it again. Today, I come to you, Lord, with a petition. Asking you to help me move my faith. Help me stir my faith and use my faith. For without faith it's impossible to please God. For he or she who comes unto God must. Say it, must. Look at somebody and say, you got to believe. See, if you're going to accomplish that that you dream to do, if you're going to accomplish that that you desire to do, that which you desire to do, you must do two things. You must believe that he is who he says he is. He's Alpha, he's Omega, he's the beginning, he's the ending, he's the first, he's the last. Everything in between. And here it is. You must believe that he is who he says he is, and you must believe he is a rewarder. Now get this, and I'm going to stop. God commands you to believe that he keeps his word to you. How dare you? I'm so sick and tired of hearing little flimsy excuses for the lack of blessing in the house of God. You can call me a prosperity preacher. You can call me whatever you want to. I tried being poor. That didn't work real good. I found out that even when I don't have another dime in my pocket, I'm still rich because I'm faithful to the Word of God. And if I'm faithful to the Word of God, He will keep me through. January the 8th of this year, I had my second major heart attack. I was at John Jenkins in Baltimore, Maryland, with Bishop Jakes. And I preached, and I walked in the next day to his living room, prepared to eat lunch. And he looked at me and he said, "You don't look good, Harold." And I just kind of made light of it. And I said, "Well, pray for him. God's man of faith and power." About 3 hours later, I repented of that. I said, "I won't ever do that again, Lord. Never again. Not even jesting. I will not do it." Now I look at somebody and say, "Lay your hands on me." Well, what did you do after your brother died of fourth stage cancer to the next person you ran into with cancer? I said, "Let me lay my hands on you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, let the healing power of Jesus Christ come into your body." Because the Lord informed me he didn't die. I took him. No, you ain't got it yet. Because some of you still looking around looking for that bottle of Stay Here. And I understand. The Lord spoke to me. Today on your calendar is September the 30th. It is the last day of the ninth month. Say the ninth month. How many know what the number 9 stands for? How many mothers are here? You've had a baby, a child. Stand up. All the mothers stand. Grandmothers stand, stand, stand. Thank you. Now be seated. You know, you want to know what the number 9 stands for? It's when that day comes when they're not walking, they're waddling. "I won't do this. I want to behave myself." They're barely making it. When they go into the hospital and the contractions start more and more, and you're standing there as a husband trying to hold on to their hand, and they hold on to your thumb and break your thumb off. It's called breakthrough. Everybody say breakthrough. Now, this may not mean a thing to you, but the Lord spoke to me at the beginning of this month. And he said, "This month is the ninth month. You tell my people wherever you go, wherever you preach, wherever you testify, this is the month when I cause breakthrough to come." Now see, some of you, that don't excite you because it didn't leap in your faith like it did mine. Because I had just got through losing a brother. I just got through going through stuff. I just got through basically having to give away everything I had because of certain things that had happened. Moving into another house, my brother passing, making sure everything was going all right. And the Lord said to me, "I made you a promise in January." Because I sit down in the chair and couldn't get up, and they rushed me to the hospital. And Dr. Jenkins pastors a great church there in Baltimore. And he called, he's on the board of the hospital, and he called the president of the hospital, and he said, "I have a friend of mine coming to your hospital. Make sure he's all right." I walked in. They said, "Well, we think we'll keep you tonight just to check things." And I was laying there, and John Jenkins came and he brought the little TV so I could watch the service live, just like many of you are watching here now, over the waves. And I turned it on, and I don't remember when I left it, but the next thing I remember, I woke up in a totally white room with a huge big clock that said 1 a.m. And I thought I had died. I literally thought that. I mean, they always tell me, you know what color white is? That's for me. Relax. I got some other colors I could tell them about. But I woke up and looked, and they had so given me such medicine until my hearing was dull, my eyesight was dull, and it looked like caricatures of people around me. There were five around me. And all I could think of, I had something going down my neck that hurt me so bad. They had put something down my neck to keep the passage open. I had had a massive heart attack in those few moments. But when I went to jerk my arm, they had tied my arms to the bed. They had tied my ankles to the bed. And it made me panic more. Anybody understand what I'm saying? And I couldn't move. And finally, a little nurse got on top of me. And she said, "Read my lips. I can't take that out of your throat yet. Just relax." Relax? I can't relax. How can I relax? Finally, after about 4 hours, they took it out. And she said, "If I take it out, will you and untie your right arm? Will that be okay?" And I said, "Okay." And they did. 10 days later, I was still in ICU. I had not put my feet on the floor. And finally, on the seventh day, I asked him to let me sit in a chair just straight up. And the Lord spoke to me and said, "I made you a promise. I would heal you." And from that moment, I didn't worry another moment about death. No, you don't have to shout. But I started getting ready to go home. And I did walk in, and I'd say, "I'm ready to go home." And he just looked at me. He said, turned everything around. He said, "You see that? When that needle gets there, and that one gets there, and that one gets there, and that one gets there, you'll be ready." And then he smiled at them. Finally, on the 10th day, I said, "I'm ready to go home." He said, "All right, tough guy." That's what he said. "Get up." They got me up. My legs were so rubby, I couldn't hardly stand. He said, "I'm going to walk you around this IC unit, the whole thing. You walk at my pace with the walker. When you get back, you lay down on the bed. If your gauges are at this, 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 and this, I'll let you go home." He got me up. My legs were just wobbling. And I said, "Thank you, Jesus. I'm not trying to be tough with you. I knew by the Holy Ghost, just like I knew this month when God said, in the ninth month, you tell them I'm going to give them breakthrough. Wherever you go, you tell them I'm going to give them breakthrough." After the second step, I started walking with him. The second step. We got back, he said, "Lay down on the bed." He is already aggravated. He really wasn't. He was glad it was happening, but he's shocked. I laid down on the bed. He said, "Okay, do this, do this, do this, do this." He checked this, this, and this. My friend Amos Dodge and John Jenkins were standing there. Every place that he said it had to go, it went above it. He got through, shook his head. He said, "Well, I guess you can go home. If you'll promise." I said, "I will." Before he'd said, I said, "I will." I have been to every doctor they could take me to in the next 3 months. I could not fly anywhere. I could not drive anywhere. And every one of them, look at the test, look at the sheet. And they said, "We see it there. It was there. You had a massive heart attack there. You had a mass right there. But we can't find it here." Now you help me shout. Somebody help me shout. I ask permission today because I want to do it. I want to be a part of this. I want to be a part of it. I know many of you have already pledged of what you're going to do between now and January. But I've asked God in this service this morning to give me 50 people that would join with me. I have to be the first. I have to. It's important for me. You just trying to give away money? No, I'm trying to stay in touch with God. One act of obedience changes everything. And I'm going to tell you, there's 50 people here today that your one act of obedience is going to change things. I want 50 people to join with me. I'm first. And I want 50 people to join with me. And either today or tonight, come back to the service tonight, the ladies' service. It's going to be an awesome night, I'm telling you. Do it this week. But I want 50 people. If this is part of your pledge, that's okay. But I want 50 people to join with me with an offering of no less than $1,000. I want you to give it today, give it tonight, give it this week. I want it soon. And I'm going to tell you what God told me he's going to do for those that obey. 50 of you, join with me and obey. Would you help me, Bishop? You're number two. All right. He's actually number one, and I know that. I want you to stand down here, if you would, on this side. He's number three. And I'm going to stand over here. And I've preached so long, I don't have time to wait on you. If you're going to be one of the ones that you will give $1,000 or more as soon as you possibly can, I don't mean just in 90 days, but I want you to join me and join my faith today by taking one of these envelopes for $1,000. Just get up out of your seat and come down here now in Jesus' name. Why don't you praise God while they're doing it? Come on, I'm waiting on you. I know it's going to happen, so you might as well shout. Take the top one, the bottom one. Somebody shout. You're not shouting. Add your faith to it. Hand me those back. This. You just stand there and hold them. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. You're going to need to bring me some more, brother. Just stand right here. Bring me some more. Somebody say hallelujah. Why aren't you shouting? Come here and help me. Come help me. Back there. Now listen, if you're not going to take one of them, shout for these that are. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Now if you're watching right now, don't turn that TV set off yet. If you're watching right now, you know where to go on the line there. There's a place where you can mark. Touch it. There's all kinds of ways you can give here. Stand here and hold it for me. You're doing good. Somebody praise the Lord. Here, hand me one. Now, I don't want you to just make a pledge. I need a bunch of you to bring it. The ones of you that are bringing it today, I want you to come put it in Bishop's hand right now. Somebody say hallelujah. Now say faith. Every one of you say, I'm doing this. You ain't saying nothing. Say it. I'm doing this by faith. By faith. I'm expecting God to bless me for my obedience in Jesus' name. Now here's what I want you to do. The rest of you that are here today that will say, I didn't come prepared to give $1,000, but I'm going to give a second offering today because I want to use my faith expecting what God is going to do for me. You stand to your feet. I want to pray over you. Whatever you're going to give, I don't care what it is, you're going to give something to stand up. Just stand up. I don't care what it is. 20, 30, 100. I'm going to give something. Now, those of you that took an envelope, you stand up with them. And the rest of you look around, see if you see somebody that's got a lot of money and say, how about letting me have some so I can give? Don't tell them to loan it to you. If you ain't got nothing, you might not pay it back. Every one of you stand and raise your hand. Now the rest of you, all of the room, stand to your feet. Because we're going to have you bring your offering down to the front. And those of you that are giving one of the $1,000, you bring it and put it in Bishop's hand. You bring it and put it in Bishop's hand. Everybody stand all over the room. Everybody. Everybody. Thank you. Yeah, you can have one. You're welcome. Somebody say hallelujah. They're still coming. Why aren't you shouting? Now that's a patty cake. Why aren't you shouting? Now lift your hand. Father, in Jesus' name, take these few words that I have spoken. Take them and use them for your glory. Now multiply it back to them as seed that is sown with expectation in the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said amen. Amen. Now we're not dismissed yet. I know we're 2 minutes over. Stand all over the room, please. Now everybody bring your offering. If you want to bring part of that, you can put it in there. You can bring the rest of it later. But bring something and lay it. The offering baskets are down here. We got some more we can put down here. Baskets, ushers, two more over here. I'm sorry, I didn't get you ready for this. If you're bringing one of those envelopes for $1,000, bring it and put it in Bishop's hand. The rest of you bring an offering and put it in the buckets and let's give God praise. Worship choir. Worship choir.
By heart I believe, by faith I receive, I know it's gonna happen. With my heart I believe, by faith I receive, I know it's gonna happen. With my heart I believe, by faith I receive, I know it's gonna happen. With my heart I believe miracles, signs, and wonders are over my life. Miracles, signs, and wonders are over my life. Say miracles, signs, and wonders are over my life. Miracles, signs, and wonders.
Oh, let's worship God.
With my heart.
Hallelujah. Just hang with us a few moments. We'll be dismissed properly, but just remain with us a few moments. Give God a praise one more time for these that choose to obey the word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Now I want you, if you will, to just stand to your feet all over the room. Everyone standing, please. Thank you. You know, I keep feeling led of the Lord. There's a pastor over here somewhere. They pointed you out. You were visiting. Where are you? Is that your wife? Join hands. The Lord spoke to me to tell you when you go back, there are struggles that have come that have brought hurt and pain from people, And God said, by the time you get back, there will be a conversion and a conviction of the Holy Spirit. He said to tell you that. You don't know my name and you don't need to know my name, but when you get back, you tell that church what God said in the name of Jesus. That name that you love and respect, God's going to do it for you in the name of Jesus. I want you to bow your head. No one walking around anymore. Just for a few moments, bow your head. If you are in this room today and you've gone through some stuff, and you know that a part of what you've gone through is because you're not right with God, it's time to get your act together. And I'm here to tell you today, on this last day of September, breakthrough month, God's about to break through for you. But you've got to ask Him to come back in. You've lost your way. You've lost your direction. There's some of you that have never been born again. You've been raised in church all your life, but you've never been born again. And there's some of you that have lost your direction with God. And today, God brought you here to tell you, this is your day for breakthrough. Every head bowed, every eye closed. How many of you will lift your hand and say, preacher, that's me. I'm not right with God. Hold your hand up high where I can see it and pray over you. Lift it up. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Lift it up. You can take it down. Thank you. In the back. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm not right with God. There's sin in my life and I know it. And I receive this word today. I put my faith to use. And I'm asking God to set me free from the power of sin. Every one of you that raised your hand, now, here's what the Bible says. You say, well, I raised my hand with heads bowed. But here's what the Bible says. He said, if you confess me before men, I confess you before my Father. If you don't confess me before men, I don't confess you. Every one of you that lifted your hand, if you don't want to come by yourself, grab the person beside you and say, go with me. But in the name of Jesus, get out of your seat and walk down here. I want to pray with you, and Bishop wants to pray with you right now. Every one of you, quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Thank you. Come quickly. Come quickly. Keep coming. You lifted your hand in the back. Come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Thank you. Somebody shout while they're coming. No, shout while they're coming. Shout while they're coming. Give God praise. Thank you, darling. Thank you. Somebody praise Him. Hallelujah. 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 They're still coming. Are you shouting? They're still coming. Are you shouting? Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want Bishop to come. We're going to pray over you right now. We're going to ask you to do something. And God's going to honor you. Remember, your faith brought you down here, so your faith will keep you. In Jesus' name.
And the Word of God says, if you'll confess with your mouth Lord Jesus and believe that God has raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. Pray these words with me. Dear Lord, I'm so sorry for my sins. Please forgive me for all the wrong I've done. I want to be saved. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe He died for me. I believe He rose from the dead. I accept Jesus as my Lord, as my Savior. And I thank you, Lord. I am saved. I am forgiven. I have new life. Come on, clap your hands and praise God for salvation. For salvation. If you prayed that prayer sincerely, every sin you've ever committed is forgiven. And Jesus Christ is your Lord. I'd like for our personal workers to give you literature, explain more perfectly the way of the Lord. give you an opportunity to join the church, to minister to you for just a moment. Would you please turn toward your right? Follow that dear young man to your right. Follow him, Brother Bradley. Lead them to the prayer room. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come on, let's praise God for salvation. Praise God for victory in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Well, let's praise God for Evangelist Harold Woodson. Ready to go. Is he gone? Oh, there you are. Thank you, sir, for your ministry. Thank you for the blessing you conveyed through you to us by the word of God. Let's give him another rousing applause. And thank you, West Angeles, for your tremendous response. You've made my heart so happy. We're on the verge of one of the greatest miracles we could ever have dreamed of. God is going to literally blow our minds by these next 2 months of involvement. Come on, let's praise God for what he's going to do. And so, dear Lord, we thank you for your presence, for your word, for this, your son, your servant, who has come to convey to us your truth and your faith. Bless us now as we go down from this place. Bring us safely together again that we might rejoice in thee. In Jesus' name, I pray. Thank God. Let the church say amen. Tonight, we'll be back at the North Campus worshiping the Lord. God bless you.